فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
So clothing is a form to humiliate you. It's a form to what? It's to humiliate you. ولذلك pay attention. Pay attention. Clothing is what humbles people. Clothing is what takes a person up. Everything is connected to clothing. True or false? Yes or no? Yeah? You go to Umrah, you're in Umrah, you're going to see every single person in a white cloth. No labels, no company. Me and you are standing together. You see the Imam of the Haram, you see? And you see the lowest of people together. Clothing is, don't think it's insignificant. Oh, all that matters is my heart. You know it doesn't. It doesn't. Clothing plays a big role. So what did Shaytan do? Shaytan, he took from them the clothing. Now that their aura is there, he humiliated them. He wanted that. That's what he wanted. That is what he wanted. Two things he did to them. The first was what? Al-Ikhraj min al-Jannah. What he did to them was he took them out of Jannah. Muhammad Amin al-Shanqiti said. Adam and Hawa were taken out of Jannah. The second thing that he did to them was what? The second thing that he did to them was Naz'u al-Libasi wa ibda'i sawati. He took their clothing away from them and he brought their private parts out in the open. And if you look at the ayah, Allah has connected leaving Jannah and the aura showing. He mentioned them both together. فَلَمَّا ذَاقَ الشَّجَرَةِ بَدَتْ لَهُمَا سَوْآتُهُمَا وَطَفِقَا يَخْصِفَانِ عَلَيْهِمَا مِنْ وَرَقِ الْجَنَّةِ No, the ayah that Allah mentioned they left Jannah was what? لَا يَفْتِنَنَّكُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ. Do not let Shaytan trial you. كَمَا أَخْرَجَ. Pay attention, brothers and sisters. I want you to ponder here. Allah connected together what? Taking your clothes off and leaving what? Leaving Jannah. Allah said to us, لَا يَفْتِنَنَّكُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ. Do not let Shaytan trial you. Do not let Shaytan cause you fitna. كَمَا أَخْرَجَ أَبَوَيْكُمْ. The way he took your father, who's our father? Adam. The way he took your father من الجنة from Jannah. ينزع عنهما لباسهما, and the way he took from them their clothing. I ask you a question. He took them out of Jannah and he took away from them their clothing. Why would Allah mention them together if they're both not important? Do you not agree? Yeah? For example, if somebody took your car and they took your, somebody robbed your car. Are you there? Are you with me, brothers? What would you say to that person? You will say, Akhi, do you know the person just took your car? Sah. Fulan took your car, stole your car. That's what you would say. But would you say, Fulan stole your car and he also stole your chewing gum? Do you see my point? You would have mentioned these two in the same context because they are not in the same weight. But it's possible that you may say, he stole your car, oh, and by the way, he also stole your laptop. Yeah? Because they're very valuable. But you wouldn't mention, oh, he also stole your socks, or he stole your chewing gum, or he stole your whatever empathetic stuff. You wouldn't say that. Are you with me? Sa'ad, you would say, he stole your Mountain Dew or your 7-Up. Yeah. But you wouldn't mention something significant like that, would you? You would. The fact that Allah told us that he was taken out of Jannah by Shaytan and he took the clothing away from them shows that both of them are of high level. High level. And this is what Shaytan will do. Libas, as I said, clothing is a blessing from Allah. Allah said in the Quran, Ya bani Adam, O the children of Adam, قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ, we have sent on you. libas and clothing. Yuwari su'atikum wa risha. We send clothing for you. What does that clothing do for you? What does it do? It what? It covers your private part. And it also protects you from the cold and the temperature outside. When it's winter, the people cover. There's less body parts that are shown. People generally cover up. They do cover up. Except when shaitan gets to people so much that even winter they're wearing miniskirts. Yeah? And it's ajeeb, there are some people who do that. You're like, I'm freezing. How are you? But one person told me, I wouldn't know because I haven't had it in my life. But somebody said to me that drinking alcohol, it makes you, it doesn't make you feel the cold a lot. Is that right? You guys don't know as well. Yeah. Sah. But have you guys heard that before? Somalis, they say pork. Somalis, they say, oh, he eats pork, that's why he doesn't feel the cold. Sah, that's what Somalis say. Yeah? But have you guys heard of the drinking alcohol, it doesn't make you... Have you heard that before? Huh? But is it real? It's real. And if you drink alcohol, that it doesn't make you, huh? Is it in terms of fact? Has it been proven? It's proven. In Russia, they drink so much vodka to keep themselves warm. Because what I see in central London sometimes when I come from uni, the ma'akil, I don't even wear that in the house when the heater is on. Yeah? So, it's ajeeb. The shaitan, the way he does that. So Allah created clothing for us. A clothing is a form of what? It's a benefit that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just the same way, my beloved brothers and sisters, you are not allowed to eat as a person. You are not allowed to eat except the food that has been made halal for you. It is also not permissible for you to wear the clothing that's impermissible for you. It's the same thing. The eating, you're allowed to eat what has been legislated for you. Okay? The clothing is the same. You're only allowed to wear what is legislated for you. This shows tamamul ubudiyyah, complete servitude. Sah? Complete servitude. And as we said, when you buy new clothes, what do you have to do? What do you do? If you bought new clothes, what do? You say a dua, right? The Prophet said, whenever he bought new clothes, he would say, or a new garment, or whatever, he would say, Allahumma laka alhamd. Oh Allah, to you is praise. Kasawtanihi. You are the one who dressed me with this. So praises to you. As'aluka khayrahu. I ask you the good. Wa khayra. مَا سُنِعَ لَهُ and the good that it has been made for. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ شَرِّهِ Oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from the evil in this clothing. وَشَرِّ مَا سُنِعَ لَهُ and the evil that it has been made for. This Tirmidhi and Abu Dawood narrated bi isnad sahih. I ask you guys a question. The sister that wears miniskirt or she wears tight trousers, does she make this dua when she buys those filthy clothes? Are you with me? Does she make that? Yeah? And if she did, would it not be contradicting what she's saying and what she's wearing? Would it not? Because what is it you're seeking refuge in? You seek refuge here in what? وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ شَرِّهِ وَشَرِّ مَا سُلِعَ لَهُ And the reason why these jeans that you're wearing, sister, was made for is to attract other men, true or false. And this doesn't only apply to the sister, it also applies to those brothers who wear true religion. He's wearing a Buddha on his back. And the Buddha, it's what? True religion. Are you there? Do you know, have you heard of it? It's true religion? Have you guys heard of it? Yeah? Huh? True religion. it's the jeans cost how much? 200, 300, and he's wearing it. This can reach apostasy. It's not just a sin. It can reach ridda, apostasy of Islam. It's like a person wearing a Christian sign. No difference. There is no difference. Be careful. Now look at what's happening. The clothing, it being a sin, has now been moved a step further. Shaytan is not giving up. Some of the women he said, take it off. Some of them he said, do this. And then he said, you know what? Through the clothing, we're going to make them leave the religion. So what is it? What's the brother wearing? He's wearing true religion. And sometimes you see them in the masjid right in front of you. You're like, A'udhu billah, true religion. And you're praying to Allah. This is dangerous. What did I say? You're not allowed to eat except that which Allah allowed. Are you with me? And that which Allah permitted. The same way is you're not allowed to wear what you want. No. You have to wear what you're told to wear. Male and female. Everyone. And that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permitted. وَلِذَلِكَ there's a hadith that Al-Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad. بِإِسْنَادٍ صَحِيحٍ with an authentic chain of narration. Abdullah ibn Umar, he said, دَخَلْتُ عَلَى النَّبِي. Abdullah ibn Umar said, I entered upon the Prophet. The Prophet was there and I came in, I came on to him. وَعَلَيَّ إِزَارٌ and I was wearing an izar. يَتَقَعْقَعُ and it was slightly below my ankles. The Prophet said to Abdullah ibn Umar, مَنْ هَذَا who is this person? قُلْتُ I said, Abdullah ibn Umar. I am Abdullah ibn Umar. The Prophet said to him, إِنْ كُنْتَ Abdullah, if you are Abdullah, meaning if you are truly the slave of Allah. إِنْ كُنْتَ Abdullah, if you are truly slave of Allah, farfa izarak, raise your garment up. Allahu Akbar. Look how clothing is connected to being a true slave. In kunta Abdullah, if you are truly the slave of Allah, farfa izarak, raise your garment above your ankles. Farafatu izari, I raised my garment ila nisf saqain, I raised it to half of my shin. فَلَمْ تَزَلْ إِزَارَتُ حَتَّى مَتْ Abdullah ibn Umar said, my garment was like that until the day I died. What is it? This was sack. This was sack is... The man's... This is your ankles. What's this? This is your ankle. And this is your... This is a what? You don't know. Body parts. You guys know your body parts. Okay, this is your? What is it again? Jameel. Right in the middle. Right there. From there, between those two, right in the middle. That's the garment of the Prophet, where he used to be. It never used to be like that. Are you with me? Alayhi salatu salam. The garment of the Prophet was like this. Alayhi salatu salam. Are we all together? Abdullah ibn Umar. Abdullah ibn Umar's garment, he said, when I raised it up and I took it up, I placed it nisf al-saq, half of my shin. And he said, I left it that way. I left it that way. The Prophet said in the hadith, izarul mu'min nisf al-saq, that the garment of the man, a mu'min, a true believer, is half his shin. Are you with me? Are you with me, brothers? Izarul mu'min. The mu'min's garment is what? Half his shin. Are you with me, brothers? Pay attention to this. Half of the shin is not obligatory. Half of the shin is not obligatory. What I just showed you here is not obligatory. That is piety and nobility at its highest. But what is obligatory on every single man is that his garment is above his ankles. It has to be. That's obligatory. Wajib. You are sinning. And it is from the major sins. Not from the minor sins. From the kabair. Kabair. for a man to have his garment below his what? Below his ankle. It's min al kaba'ir. Kaba'ir al dhunub. If you have a trousers, what do you do? Now, I see some brothers who fold their garments, their trousers. What do they do? Yeah? What do? They fold it. I'll tell you a good idea. In the salah, it's prohibited for the person to fold their clothing. You're not allowed to. A man is not to pray, he's not allowed to pray like this in the salah. You can't. You have to open everything. So when you're in the salah, you're not allowed to fold your trousers. And you can't be. So what do you do? What I do is, I cut all my trousers. Look what I did to these trousers. I went home, I got a scissors. I got the two legs together, just cut it. It can be Adidas trousers if it wants. It can be a Adibas trousers if it wants. Yeah. It can be whatever trousers it wants. Go, and what do? Just cut it, brothers. Maybe one or two you're going to have to need sometimes to have, just in case you want to go to the gym or you want to go football or something and it's cold and you want to wear it, but make sure it's above your ankles. But when you want to come to the masajid or you want to cut your trousers, and I'll tell you why I say that, for two reasons. It's easy for you to go back to what you were before if it's folded. Are you there? But if you've cut them, you have to work with that. Second is that every time you come to the salah, you're having a problem. You're having a problem. You don't have to go wild in cutting the trousers. I just always love my garments to be half my shin. I would just like it to be above my ankles. That's just me specifically. I like it that way. But if you as an individual, you like yours not to be that way, you just have to have it above your ankles. So you can just go just a little bit above your ankles. Just a bit, cut it, that's it. A little bit. It doesn't have to be very big. Can it be up on the ankles? On the ankles? Yes, it can. Because the prohibition is below the ankles. But again, if it's on the ankles, it can always go below it. Again, you are playing with fire. So it's what? That is above the ankles. This is obligatory for men. It's obligatory. Abdullah ibn Umar, he said, that day onwards, my garment was what? Was half the shin. Now you find brothers who tell sisters you have to wear hijab, you have to cover up, and etc. Which is something that's not wrong. Muslims call each other to good and they prohibit each other from what? From evil. But halla, if only you did what was obligatory on you as well, which is to have your garment above your ankles. And if only you let your beard grow as well. Because the things that are meant to be done for the male that are obligatory are these things. Your beard and your garment being above your ankles. So it's something that Abdullah ibn Umar. But what do I want from that story, that narration? The thing I want from that narration is how the Prophet said to him, when he said, I am Abdullah ibn Umar. He said, if you are truly Allah's slave, I realized after many years that the problem with the people is, even if you look at the sisters that don't want to wear the hijab, if you actually talk to them, it's actually reached a point where they don't accept that they are slaves. They verbally may not say that, but by action, they're not accepting that they're slaves. And a master can tell them what to do. And a master can prohibit them. They don't. Are you with me? Sister Allah said, well, let him judge me the day of judgment. Are you with me? Or when some of them say, only Allah can judge me. Do you think does that bring you comfort knowing that only Allah can judge you? Because when Allah judges you, it's not easier than me judging you. I don't know how that brings you comfort. Allah's judgment is more. Aisha, what did she say? Manukisha udib. Anyone who is judged, the day of judgment is punished. Aisha said this. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. She didn't say that, sorry, the Prophet said that. She narrated from the Prophet. The Prophet said this. He said, Manukisha. Anyone who is questioned and is interrogated the day of judgment and is judged, he's punished. Why do we want to be from the 70,000 that enter Jannah without no accountability? Because the fact that somebody interrogates you, I ask you guys a question. You got your insurance, you got your MOT done, you got your road tax, your car is in good tact, everything is good. The police stop you and they ask you a question. Doesn't that trouble you? Isn't it hardship on you? Brother, you're legit, everything is right. Your files are together. You can't be better than you are today. The minute those blue lights come on, blue, 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 behind you, like, oh, what happened? Oh, you start shivering. When they pull you over and they say to you, hi, there, sir, do you know why we stopped you? You're like, okay. Now it's a guessing game. No, sir, I don't know. Try again. Okay, I was speeding. Okay, good. How fast were you driving? Sir, everything that you have, because you know that accountability is unrestricted. They can just say, okay, I'm just going to look at your tires. Oh, hey, open the bonnet. Hey, open the boot. Sir Abu Bakr. Yeah, they can say any of that to you. So you know as an individual that worry comes. What comfort do you get when you say, Allah is going to judge me? Who doesn't only know all of that? He knows before he even questions you what you're worried about. Because this police officer, he can actually sometimes walk away and your car is not insured. Like, wow, he didn't even see that. He did not see that. Or your car doesn't have MOT. Or your tire is one of its punctured. He didn't see it. Sah? And you may get away. Allah Allah. So when the sister says, only Allah can judge me, is actually even something much that should scare you. Because at least these people who are judging you, you might get away from them. It's for Allah, you don't. And then this is Wahyu Shaytan. Shaytan is sending his revelation again. The point that the fa'idah that we're going to go into right now is the virtue of covering yourself. We're going to mention فضل التستر. What virtue does it have to cover yourself up? A woman covering herself is a مطلب خلقي عظيم. A woman covering herself, it shows that she has good etiquette. Number one, good etiquette. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Are you there? A sister who says, sisters who are covering up don't have good manners. No, you don't have good manners. Because the first good manner is a tasattur, to cover yourself up. That is from the first etiquette that's needed. Are you with me? It's one of the first etiquettes that is needed. ولذلك, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala covers his aura. He used to make dua for that. Our Prophet, to show you the seriousness of it. Ibn Majah narrated with a chain which is authentic from Abdullah ibn Umar that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he never used to leave this dua in the morning and in the evening, both times. This dua is sabahin wal masa. What is it? اللهم إني أسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة اللهم أسألك العفو والعافية في ديني ودنياي وأهلي ومالي اللهم استر عوراتي وآمن روعاتي واحفظني من بين يدي ومن خلفي وعن يميني وعن شمالي ومن فوقي وأعوذ بك أن أغتال من تحتي. What is it that he would say? اللهم استر عوراتي. Oh Allah, cover my aura. Cover my what? My aura. Don't let it be exposed to the people. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? So the Prophet would make dua fi sabahi wal masa. Covering yourself up is an indication of what? Shyness. If a woman covers up, it shows that she's shy. If a man covers up, he shows that he's shy. And wallahi, shyness is from the greatest branches of al-Iman. And covering up and shyness are bonded together, and they are together all the time. Listen to the famous hadith. Abu Dawud narrated, Sheikh Nasir authenticated, that the Prophet ﷺ is time, a man, he, أن رجلا, أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رأى رجلا, the Prophet saw a man, يغتسل بالبزار بلا إزار. A man was showering outside, in the open. He was just showering. Aura, everything open. فصعد المنبر. The Prophet ﷺ, he went on the pulpit. He climbed, he went to the pulpit. فحمد الله وأثنى عليه. He did إن الحمد لله. And then he praised, praising on the Prophet ﷺ, praising on Allah. Then the Prophet said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ, verily Allah, حَيِّيٌّ, Allah is shy. He is what? سِتِّيرٌ, He is one who covers. يُحِبُّ الْحَيَاءَ وَالسِّتْرَ, and Allah loves the shy one and the one who covers. فَإِذَا اغْتَسَلَ أَحَدُكُمْ, if one of you, he is showering or is having a bath, فَلِيَسْتَتِرْ, hide yourself. If one of you is having a shower, hide yourself. So what does this show? The bond between shyness and what? The covering up. And as you all know, if shyness goes, what happens? إِذَا لَمْ تَسْتَحِي فَاصْنَعْ مَا شِئْتَ. If somebody is not shy, then the reality is, do as you wish. I ask you guys a question. When you see a person who's very shy, بِاللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ, by Allah, I ask you guys this sincere question. Are they not more adorable? Do you not admire them than when they are a person who's just all out in people's faces? Which one do you like? Yeah? Which one? Yeah? I remember a time there was a brother. They told him to do a lecture. It was a very knowledgeable brother. But they told him to do a little reminder because the speaker was coming a bit late. So they told him to do a lecture. So he sat down to do the lecture. I was listening. I was very young at this time. I was watching him. He went and he was very nervous. I could see his hand wouldn't stop moving. It was not stopping. And when he came on, whilst he was talking, he cried in the wrong place. And his cry was a khushu. It wasn't that, it was, oh, the ayat. He just started crying. And he wouldn't stop crying because he became so nervous. He got very scared. I remember the people in the masjid, everybody hugged him. Everybody admired him. They hugged him. They were true or false. ولذلك the Prophet saw a man advising another man. And the Prophet said, what are you advising? He said, Ya Rasulullah, this man is too shy. I'm telling him, take it easy with the shyness. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Da'ahu, leave him. فَإِنَّ الْحَيَاءَ لَا يَأْتِي إِلَّا بِالْخَيْرِ. Leave him, for verily shyness does not bring except good. Wallahi, one day I was on a... my mum used to tell me, when I was young, to take my sister from school. She would tell me to take my sister from school. Now my sister used to go to a school called Elizabeth Garrett Anderson, which is in North London, Angel. EGA, they call it. This is only a girls' school. It's a what? Specific to girls. So I would have to go and pick my sister up from school. So I would go into the school because my sister, she needed help. So I would go into the school and I would go to the office. She would be waiting for me there. She wouldn't be allowed to leave. So I would have to go through the school. Now I would go through this women. Ya Ilahi. Ya Ilahi. It made me literally say to my mom, Mom, I don't want to pick up my sister. The hate that I used to have to go in the public transport. The things that those women would say to me on the bus, and the way that they would talk to me, and how they would shout at me. I remember a time I'm sitting with my sister. A girl came, she told my sister, get up. She tapped my sister on the shoulder, she said, get up, I need to talk to your brother. And I am shocked. My mouth dropped. I told my sister, sit, don't move. She's like, get up, honey. Then she just said, she came between my sister and I from the back chair. She put her face in. She's like, I just want to talk to you. Hakada. No shyness. Wallahi, nothing is left. Ana muta'ajjib. I reached a point, I said, Mom. First I thought, okay, you know, double-decker buses. I thought maybe it's the top. This is where the fitan and the malahim and the trials and tribulations is coming from. Maybe I have to go to the bottom one. So I went to the back seat at the front of the bus, at the front, you know, where the priority seat, where disabled people come. Are you there? They stand. They sit. I would sit there just so I don't get in contact with them. That same girl came into the bus, she's like, oh, you're sitting here today. She saw me again, she came in. And that's how it was. In school, wallahi, the loudest in the class, the most problematic people were who? The girls. It was the girls. That was my time. Is it still the same like now? Yeah? Is it like that? There's no shyness. Things that girls have said to me face to face on buses picking up my sister, I would never even be able to say them. Staghrabt. A person would say that. One time, one said something to me, I became so shocked. She's like, oh, you're shy. Like that. Staghrabt. Istighrab. The way that the shyness has been taken out of them, nothing is left. Now what's sad is Muslims are taking it on easily without any problems. You see a Muslim girl come up to you like, Halima, Amina, I know you. Because when she's a Somali, like, be quiet, sit down. I know you. I know you very well. That's the reality. So what they're doing is they're fighting with the concept of shyness. I'm going to conclude with this long story. This story is Nabiullah, Bukhari and Muslim both narrated on the authority of Abu Huraira. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Inna Musa kana rajulan hayyan sitira. Musa was a very shy man. And Musa used to cover up. La yura min jildihi shay'un. No one would ever see his flesh. No one would see his body parts. Istihya'an minhu. All of this was out of shyness. Pay attention. This is a prophet of Allah. Who is he? He's a prophet of Allah. Today, it's become a praise. I ain't shy. That's what they say. This is a Nabi min Anbiya Illahi, from the five chosen prophets. Ulul Azmi min al-Rusul. He's been described as a what? Hay, shy. إن موسى كان رجلا حييا ستيرا لا يرى من جلده شيء استحياء منه فآذاه من آذاه من بني إسرائيل. بني إسرائيل, now they harmed him. What did they say to him? قالوا ما يستتر هذا التستر إلا من عيب بجلده إما برص وإما أدرة. They said the reason why Musa is covering himself up like this, and the reason why he's shy, this shy, is because he has a fault. He has an illness which he suffers from. He's covering himself because of an illness. He has leprosy. So an illness, he suffers from an illness. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ أَرَادَ أَن يُبَرِّئَهُ مِمَّا قَالُوا لِمُوسَى. And Allah wanted. What did Allah want? Allah wanted to free Musa from that which they said about him. He wanted to free him. Now pay attention. Pay attention. The way Allah freed Musa from this accusation was not to tell Musa to take his clothes off. You don't tell him. Sah? Are you with me? So what happened? فَخَلَى يَوْمًا. One day, Nabilahi Musa, he went by himself alone. فَوَضَعَ ثِيَابَهُ. He would go somewhere far. He wanted to shower. So he placed his clothing on a rock. عَلَى الْحَجَرِ ثُمَّ اغْتَسَلَ. And then he what? And then he what? He showered. فَلَمَّا فَرَغَ أَقْبَلَ إِلَى ثِيَابِ. And then when he finished, he went towards his clothing. لِيَأْخُذَ. So he can take it. وَإِنَّ الْحَجَرَ عَدَى بِثِيَابِهِ. What happened is that the rock took away from him his clothing. فَأَخَذَ مُوسَى عَصَاهُ. نبي الله موسى took his stick. وَطَلَبَ الْحَجَرَ. And he went running after the stone. فَجَعَلَ يَقُولُ. He kept saying, ثَوْبِي حَجَرٌ. My clothes. Stone, you've taken my clothes. He kept saying that. حَتَّى انْتَهَى إِلَى مَلَئٍ مِّن بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ. Until he came to a gathering of Bani Israel. فَرَآهُ عُرْيَانًا. They saw him naked. أَحْسَنَ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ. In the best way Allah ever created him. وَأَبْرَاهُ مِمَّا يَقُولُونَ. And Allah freed him from that which he said about him. وَقَامَ الْحَجَرُ فَأَخَذَ ثَوْبَهُ فَلَبِسَهُ. Musa, when this rock stood, he took his clothing and he wore it. وَطَفِقَ بِالْحَجَرِ ضَرْبًا بِعَصَاهُ. Musa got angry. He hit the rock with his stick. فَوَاللَّهِ by Allah. إِنَّ بِالْحَجَرِ لَنُدَمًا مِنْ أَثَرِ ضَرْبَتِي. The rock, it cracked in the hit of Nabiullah Musa alayhi salam. He hit it 3 or 4 or 5 times, the Prophet said. And as you all know, Musa was a very strong man. Very strong man. Nabiullah Musa, he killed a man with a punch. Nabiullah Musa, فَوَكَزَهُ. Wakz is one knock, one punch. You with me? He made the man die. Not only that, when the women were standing next to the well, وَلَمَّا تَوَجَّهَ تِلْقَى مَدْيَنَ. When he came to Madian, and when did he find 2 women? Musa, he got the bucket into the well, and he brought the bucket out by himself, whereas the rest of the men, they used to help each other. He would do it by himself. He got them the water, he gave it to them, and that's why he was employed, because of his strength. So he's very strong. And then the ayah came down, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ آذَوْا مُوسَى فَبَرَّاهُ اللَّهُ مِمَّا قَالُوا وَكَانَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَجِيهًا. This story, it combines between shyness and covering yourself up. And a person should be of that. And inshallah ta'ala, we will speak about بإذن الله الكريم in our next lesson, inshallah ta'ala. We will start بإذن الله الكريم, the book written by Sheikh Nasir رحمه الله تعالى. This was just a muqaddimah, an introduction.